Hello everyone, I am Dr. Yogesh Pawde. In this lecture series on clinical enzymology, we are going to cover in this fourth session on enzyme profiles in pancreatic disorders. We are going to cover serum amylase and serum lipase. What are the enzyme profiles in pancreatic disorders? These are the specific learning objectives. As these specific learning objectives are given in the description box, I am not going to describe these specific learning objectives here. We are going to move on to amylase. Its enzyme classification number is 3.2.1.1. We all know what is the use of serum amylase. Yeah, it is a 1,4-alpha-D-glucan-glucanohydrolase. Okay, it catalyzes the hydrolysis of 1,4-alpha-glucosidic linkage in polysaccharides, digest starch. It is a calcium metal enzyme and pH optima is 6.9 to 7.0. Its molecular weight is 54,000 to 62,000. It can easily pass through renal glomeruli. This particular fact of its smaller molecular weight size is very important, because of which it can easily pass through renal glomeruli, and it is the only enzyme which is normally found in urine. It is normally excreted in urine. Its molecular weight is 54,000 to 62,000. Remember this. Its normal reference range is 28 to 100 international unit per liter and 80 to 180 SOMOGA units. This fact of its excretion in urine is very important so far as MCQ and VIVA questions are considered. Then what are the sites in which amylase is present in high concentration? We all know mainly pancreas and salivary glands are going to produce amylase because they digest starch, but other tissues like testes, ovaries, fallopian tubes, muscle, lungs and adipose tissue also have production of amylase. Serum amylase and pancreatic amylase are two normally found isoenzymes which are present in serum and urine. These isoenzymes are products of two closely linked loci, but they are different though they are closely linked, and on chromosome number 1. So pancreatic amylase and salivary amylase are two true isoenzymes, and they are synthesized from two closely linked loci on chromosome 1. Remember this. And rest of the tissues which are producing amylase, like testes, ovaries, fallopian tubes, muscle, lungs and adipose tissue, they are producing isoforms of serum amylase. And isoforms of serum amylase are produced because of post-translational modifications of deamidation, glycosylation and deglycosylation to form several isoforms. Okay, these two closely linked loci are forming a product which undergoes post-translational modification and gives several isoforms. Coming to the clinical significance of serum amylase, serum amylase activity is increased in acute pancreatitis because the pancreas tissue size is more compared to salivary glands. You will always find extent of rise of serum amylase activity in pancreatitis will be more compared to the salivary gland tissue pathologies, right? So you will find rise of serum amylase activity more than 1000 SOMOGA units in case of acute pancreatitis and less than 1000 SOMOGA units in case of mumps, that is a salivary gland pathology or disorder. Then meningoencephalitis, perforated peptic ulcer. Here, because small intestine is also producing small quantity of serum amylase, you will find rise of serum amylase activity, but that is going to be less than 500 SOMOGA units. Intestinal obstruction and opioid administration. Again, intestinal obstruction is going to increase serum amylase activity because it will cause necrosis of the small intestinal tissue, causing release of serum amylase into circulation. Serum amylase activity is also increased in salpingitis and ruptured tubal pregnancy. The fact that fallopian tubes are producing serum amylase was used in older days to diagnose ectopic pregnancy. In older days, you know, ultrasonographic investigations were not available. So this serum amylase was used to diagnose ruptured tubal pregnancy and ectopic pregnancies as well. Ovarian malignancies also show you increase in serum amylase activity. biliary tract disease, mesenteric infarction, because small intestinal tissue will be impacted because there is no blood supply to small intestinal tissue, causing necrosis of the small intestinal tissue, leading to release of serum amyloid into the circulation. And here, renal insufficiency. We have just seen the fact that because of its smaller molecular weight, that is 54,000 to 62,000, it is excreted in urine. And that's why in case of renal insufficiency, serum amylase will not be excreted in urine, causing increase in its serum levels. So when it is not excreted in urine, its serum levels are going to be increased. And there is one more condition that is called as macroamylasemia, where the molecular weight of the serum amylase molecule will be more than the usual molecular weight, that is 54,000 to 62,000. If it is more than that is called as macroamylasemia. And what will happen if the molecular size is more? That will prevent that molecule from excretion through kidney, so it will not appear in urine. So you will find that serum levels of amylase are increasing and urine levels of amylase are decreasing. So that is a condition called as macroamylasemia. And these are the conditions, these two conditions in which serum amylase activity is decreased: acute liver diseases and diabetes mellitus. Probably because in case of diabetes mellitus, the endocrine function is defective or some disorder related to that manifest into diabetes mellitus. And along with that, some exocrine component is also affected. That's why serum amylase activity is decreased in diabetes mellitus. Then, as we have already discussed, that in case of clinical enzymology, the enzymes we are studying in different disorders have a typical pattern of its rise, peak, fall to its basal levels, right? So here, in case of amylase, all starts rising in 5 to 8 hours. It reaches its peak level at 12 to 72 hours. Then it returns to baseline in 3 to 4 days. So it remains elevated till 3 to 4 days. Then coming to serum lipase, its enzyme classification number is 3.1.1.3. Here it is triacylglycerol acyl hydrolase. It hydrolyzes triacylglycerols, catalyzes the hydrolysis of glycerol esters of long chain fatty acids. Its molecular weight is even smaller than serum amylase. Here it is only 48,000. If you remember, molecular weight of serum amylase, it was 54,000 to 62,000. Okay, so this is even smaller than serum amylase molecule, and it's small enough to get filtered but totally reabsorbed. This fact is very important. Both serum amylase and serum lipase are filtered through kidney, but because lipase has even smaller molecular weight, it gets totally reabsorbed by the renal tubules. So though filtered, it will not appear in urine. If you get an MCQ that the enzyme which appears in urine, you are going to hit only serum amylase, because lipase is going to be totally reabsorbed and it will not appear in urine, though both are filtered and not normally detected in urine because it is totally reabsorbed. Then what are the sites in which serum lipase is found in high concentration? Obviously, it is going to be pancreas, but small quantities are also produced in lingual salivary glands. There is gastric lipase also, and pulmonary and intestinal mucosa are found to produce some quantity of serum lipase. Its normal reference range is up to 45 international unit per liter. The lipase concentration in pancreas, to compare with other tissues and serum, I'll tell you, the concentration of lipase in the pancreas is about 5000 fold greater than other tissues. 5000 fold compared to other tissues. And the concentration gradient, if we compare the concentration of lipase in pancreas and in serum, you'll find that the concentration of lipase in pancreas is about 20,000 fold compared to serum activity. Okay, so even a small fraction of pancreas, you know, getting necrosed or some pathology related to it is going to manifest into increased serum lipase activity. So that is so sensitive and specific at the same time to diagnose pancreatitis. Coming to the clinical significance of lipase, the activity is found to be increased in acute pancreatitis, perforated peptic ulcer because small intestine also produces small quantity of lipase. Then intestinal obstruction for the same reason. Then mesenteric vascular obstruction leading to necrointestinal cells. Then obstruction of pancreatic duct leading to stagnation and absorption in circulating blood vessels. Renal insufficiency here. Again, if lipase is not filtered because of renal failure, what is going to happen? Its serum level is going to be increased because it is not filtered. And reabsorption process will be later on, but if it is not filtered, its level is going to be increased in serum. And the same disorders which decreases amylase activity, like acute liver diseases and diabetes mellitus, are going to decrease lipase activity as well. Okay, these two reasons, these two causes, decreases amylase as well as lipase activity, along with one more reason, that is vitamin A deficiency. Vitamin A deficiency leads to decrease in lipase activity. Now coming to the typical behavior of lipase in acute pancreatitis, it starts increasing within 4 to 8 hours. It is almost similar to that of amylase. We'll compare those two rise, peak and fall patterns of lipase and amylase. It reaches peak level at 24 hours and returns to baseline in 8 to 14 days. So it remains elevated for longer time compared to amylase. And elevations between 2 to 50 times is reported because it is very sensitive and specific. The ratio of pancreas concentration to serum level is 20,000 to 1. So even a small pathology of pancreas is going to show you vast increase in serum lipase activity. So coming to the comparison of pancreatic markers in case of acute pancreatitis, you'll see these two markers will show you this kind of rise, peak and fall pattern. So serum lipase and serum amylase, both start increasing at the same time. The peak of serum amylase is early as compared to lipase, but the peak of lipase will be sharp compared to amylase. It is 20 to 24 hours only, and for amylase it is 12 to 72 hours. The peak will be a plateau kind of phase, but here the lipase will show you a sharp peak if we plot it on a graph. And coming to the duration for which both are increased, okay, so amylase will keep elevated till 3 to 4 days, and 4 days will be required to bring it to the normal level. And here in case of lipase, you will see that 8 to 14 days are required to bring it to the normal level. Acute pancreatitis was transient and patient might have recovered for some time, but even in that case also you will find the serum lipase level increased, and you can find out that yeah, it was a recent episode of acute pancreatitis. The patient fortunately has to report to you within 8 to 14 days to get diagnosed that it was acute pancreatitis. So serum lipase will help you in that case. Thank you very much, students. And if you really like the content and the effort we have taken to prepare the presentation, kindly hit like button and share the video. And if you are not subscribed yet, kindly subscribe to the channel and hit the bell button so that you get the notifications of upcoming videos in real time. Thank you so much, guys. Please keep motivating us.